Yo, 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 what's up, family? Before we start the video, please leave a like, subscribe, and share the end in what you can. Just so we can get out there a little bit more. With that being said, let's run into the video. So today we'll be doing something a little bit different. I've been looking for some trade articles to react to. I don't know what I just moved myself, but I might have to write some myself. If you didn't know or don't remember, I do write articles myself for a website, shout out Peach Basket. But I'll be reacting to this one, trade predictions for every NBA team this season. This was about a week ago, October 26th, so let's see. Oh, I haven't given my thoughts on the Harden trade, so I'll do that here. I hate to say I don't care. I don't like how Harden gets his way every time. You know, he is an all-time great, whether you like it or not. I just don't like the diva aspect. I'm not saying you can't go for what you like. I'm not saying you can't put yourself in a situation that you like, but it's just every single time some shit goes wrong, every single time he faces some adversity, he just decides to up and leave shit. So I don't like that aspect of it, but for the Clippers, they haven't had a pick and roll point guard in a long time, a guy that can, you know, really, really pass the ball. James Harden is still one of the best passers in the game. How he coexists with Paul George and Kawhi Leonard still remains to be seen. I like this for the 76ers for the same reason for every team that ever traded him. It's just you're getting rid of a disgruntled guy. You're getting rid of that in your locker room. I like that they got KJ Martin back. Somebody that's young, athletic, is going to have to shoot better on this team. But Batum could maybe play a role. They did trade P.J. Tucker too. And I think that might open up their offense a lot. I know P.J. Tucker is one of those guys that, you know, he does a lot of things outside of the stat sheet. Hard nose, plays some small ball five. He does bring a sense of switching that I think the Clippers need it at the five. I think Tucker can bring them something at that small ball five in the playoffs if they decide to go their route. But yeah, the 76ers, I kind of like the return. They did get picks that they can use later. I think this is what this trade is. I think they're gaining assets to use later. Yeah, I feel like the 76ers did okay. I feel like they could have got at least Terrence Mann, but they did get a score in Marcus Morris, who they can use about 15 minutes a night. See if he can get 10 points in those 15 minutes. KJ, again, who I like them getting in his deal. And Nick Batum, who can play in that P.J. Tucker role. And he does bring some of the same veteran qualities that that P.J. Tucker brings. So, but with that being said, let's get right into it. The first one is the Hawks trade Clint Capella. So I don't know if these are actually going to be like trade offered. Like, are they actually going to give us the trades or just people? Which is cool, which is fine. I'll talk about it anyway. So yeah, Clint Capella, I like Onyeka Okongwu a lot. There's been, all right, let's trade Clint Capella so we can get Okongwu to start. That's been happening for like 2 years now. There are teams that can use Clint Capella though. I think the Grizzlies are a team that really needs center play. Xavier Tillman's good. He's always going to produce even though he's undersized. Jaren Jackson's not much of a rebounder. So Clint Capella could be really good for them. Let's see if they give at least teams. Okongwu will probably come off the bench. Move Capella for more shooting will open up the spot and start lining up for the five. Yeah, so it's just the same thing. I think the Grizzlies could use them, but not a lot of teams out there need center play. There's a couple teams, but off the top of my head, the team that jumped off the page first is the Grizzlies with the Steven Adams entry and stuff like that. So, two Celtics are done. I actually don't know about this. Like, I get what they're saying. Like, we have a great team. Our top six, of course, I think is the best in the NBA. But in the Jrue Holiday introduction interviews and the Chris Porzingis ones, Brad Stevens was, you know, he mentioned his first round picks he still had to trade a lot. So that made me think that he was always going to be calling teams to try to get some more depth. If this bench unit does not show that they can get the job done and our top six has to play 38 to 40 minutes every night, Brad Stevens will use those first round picks that we still have. We got a couple more second round picks in the past draft where we drafted Jordan Walsh. We had the 25th overall pick in the smart trade. We traded all the way down to, I think, 37 to pick Walsh. And all of those trade downs, we got multiple second round picks. And you've seen last trade deadline where quality role players were going for 5 second round picks or some shit like that. So I don't agree that we're done, like in the sense of Brad's not calling. We might not make one, but I don't think we're far. I think we're far from Brad being done making trades, really. The Nets, what they say about the Nets? Like, Boston, they won't trade between now and February. The reason, but transaction is a little different, though, of course. Brooklyn's big trades came in the middle of last season when they all threw to Kevin Durant. Thanks to the deal with Brooklyn, now it's versatility, largely in part. Okay, I think, all right, they still have Royce O'Neal, right? I don't know about this. Now, I'm not opposed to agreeing with it. Let's say the Nets are bad. I think they have a lot of pieces contending teams can use. Dorian Finney-Smith, I think a team offered him a first or two firsts for him. They said no. Royce O'Neal is a guy I think that's expendable. A team offered them four firsts for Mikal Bridges. Of course, you say no to that. Not of course, but he's the cornerstone at this point of their team. A guy like Cam Johnson, they just extended, so they won't be trading him. Ben Simmons looks pretty good. He's averaging almost a triple-double this season, 18-8. Yeah, I don't know about that. Trying to hold straight Gordon Hayward. Okay, I agree with this because this is the most valuable Gordon Hayward has been in a long time. Not because his play has increased. He's still injury-prone. He's still a guy that can't be injured. But because he's on the last year of his deal, it's not that much of a risk. You're not tied up to him. His salary isn't tied up into your books. This is a low-risk, high-reward type of trade if a team were to make this. Gordon Hayward can still be a really, really good piece. He's solid. He goes at his own pace. He can score the ball. He gets to his spots. He does that little turnaround. He's efficient. He's 6'8". He can guard. His defense has taken a dip because of all the injuries and just because he's gotten older. But this is a player that somebody will take a chance on. I'm banking on somebody trading for Gordon Hayward. He doesn't fit the Hornets timeline, of course. And I think he can still average about 10 points, be efficient on a really good team. And again, I think this happens this year solely based on the fact that he has a one-year deal. Let's see if they mention that. Right, a half-season rental on a versatile forward who has an expiring contract. Low risk, high reward. Oh! See, this is kind of hard to see because when Lonzo was healthy, the Chicago Bulls were a really, really fun team to watch. I think he was the piece, like, that was the offseason they signed him and DeRozan, and I think they also got Caruso that year. Like, that team was really fun. The Chicago Bulls are not a horrible defensive team, but like, the Chicago Bulls have never been the same defensively without Lonzo, and I think Caruso was hurt a lot last year, but this is hard to see. Now, I don't think it's impossible to happen. I don't know what teams take a chance on Lonzo right now because of, you know, his injury. He hasn't played in a long time. I would love to see Lonzo play again. He's a guy that I've been really rooting for coming out of UCLA. And he is the prototypical point guard in today's NBA. He's 6'6", an impeccable passer, an impeccable defender, and he got that jump shot up to a very respectable level. He's a 3-and-D playmaking point guard. He's unselfish. You know, he's a pest, and he's athletic. He's a prototypical point guard in the NBA. Bro, why does that look like a fucking wheelchair? That's crazy. That like a wheelchair. But yeah, I don't know because his contract was run through 2024-2025. If he picks up his player option, which I think he will because he hasn't played. I wish they gave trade offers so we can like gauge with teams. I guess like a Wizards. I don't think Tyus Jones is a guy that's going to be there for long. I think Lonzo next to Jordan Poole and Denny and Koulibaly. I really like that fit for the Wizards if they can get this done somehow. And I think Chicago would take a guy like Tyus Jones. Caruso's not really playing point guard. They have Ayo Dosunmu. They have Kobe White, who, again, is a scoring guard. They have Javon Carter. I think Tyus Jones would fit good with them. I actually don't hate that. So maybe that could be a little trade-off right there. Cleveland Cavaliers explored the markets for Jared Allen and Donovan Mitchell. Let's see what they said. The Cleveland Cavaliers, two big ones, really lean regular season, but the offense fell apart during the five-game first. Man, if Mobley fails to add a reliable outside shot. So the Jared Allen thing I'm getting is for spacing purposes. He's a great defender. He's a great rebounder. But I don't hate this. I think the Grizzlies need a center. They have some young guys. They have some wings like a Zaire Williams. But that's not going to be enough for Jared Allen. Yeah, I don't really like the Grizzlies package. The Donovan Mitchell thing, a lot of this trade buzz about Donovan is coming from the fear that he might want to go to the Knicks or he might want to sign with a different team that's, you know, not losing a player for nothing. Donovan Mitchell, last we checked, still wants to play in NY. Still kind of the scuttlebutt, clock ticking, important year for the Cavs. We'll see. Dallas Mavericks trade Tim Hardaway Jr. I mean, I guess. Tim Hardaway's contract feels like the safest bet for him. You have Tim Hardaway, who's making about 17. You have a guy like Rashawn Holmes that they picked up in the offseason that makes about 12. I think Cleveland makes around $8 million. Yeah, I guess you could trade Tim Hardaway. Tim Hardaway is actually a nice piece off the bench for this team. He's a scorer. He's a shooter. He is getting older. You could maybe look to add more defense with this move. You get a defensive wing back. I'm not sure, but you could probably attach some seconds along with Tim Hardaway's contract to get you like an actual 3-and-D wing, not just a 3 wing. So I don't really have much to say about that. Denver Nuggets are done making trades. I think this actually might be a team that's done making trades. You lose Bruce Brown, you lose Jeff Green, a team that might have some questions on the bench, but again, Peyton Watson is playing great right now. Christian Brown, again, who's doing everything off the bench. Zeke Nnaji, who they just extended, so I'm guessing they have some sort of faith in him. If there is a team that is most likely to stand pat and do nothing, I do think it's the Denver Nuggets. So, Pistons trade Bojan Bogdanović or Alec Burks. Now, this, I think they're more likely to trade Alec Burks because even though Bogdanović doesn't fit their timeline, he's a little older. I think Alec Burks might be the realistic option here between the two of these guys. No, he's a 6'6 point guard who can handle, who can shoot, who can defend. I wouldn't mind Alec Burks on the Celtics at all because he can play the one and the two. He's a little older, but I feel like if we give them some seconds, I feel like the Pistons would do that. But I have several Cy Young players, including Cade Cunningham, Jaden Iverson, Tonsi, Jalen Duren. However, they might not finish top 10 in the East. If their hopes of playing look far-fetched in January, likely they'll win. Okay. Yeah, but I don't have a problem with that. I don't. Golden State trades Moses Moody. They tried to play this thing where they have the old and the new, which worked when they won a championship a couple years ago. Moses Moody does look good. Kuminga is starting to look good. This is probably like a sail high pitch where, you know, you sail high on these young guys and you get quality role players in now so you can win with, you know, Chris Paul, who's old, Draymond Green, who's old, Steph Curry is also getting older, Klay's old. I can kind of see it. I just, you know, it doesn't really fit now because it's a sail high thing. So as far as the viewer's eye, it's not really gonna seem like something they should do right now. But if they could get a good enough player for him or another one of those young guys, a possible last dance type season, the Warriors will want to make an upgrade at some point between now and February. Get the young, if you really want to win now, get the young guys out, go get a quality player. Houston Rockets trade Deshaun Tate or Reggie. They have Reggie. I forgot they had Reggie Bullock. Guy that can help contending teams. Tate, I think, has just been pushed out because they've gotten a lot of players over the last 2 years. You know, same thing happened to KJ Martin. KJ asked for a trade. When they drafted Jabari Smith Jr., he asked for a trade. He just got traded this year because they have a lot of guys now. There isn't a lot of playing time. I didn't like their offseason. I don't like them signing Fred VanVleet to that type of money. I don't mind Fred VanVleet, the player, as much as I do the contract, especially when you knew you had the fourth overall pick and Amen Thompson was staring you in the face the entire time, and then you go out and sign a point guard for $40 million, who I think isn't worth that money. He's an undrafted player who worked his ass off. I'm happy that he got the money, but for the sake of the Houston Rockets and the roster construction, solely based on the fact that you knew, you 90% knew that you had Amen Thompson at that position. The top three was locked. The order, you might could say, everybody knew Victor was going one. Two and three, there was a lot of discussion, but it was only between two players, between Scoot and Brandon Miller. You knew at four, you had your pick of the Thompson brothers and anybody else other than those three. So just based off that fact, I wouldn't have gave Fred VanVleet that money. The Dylan Brooks thing, he's a little less. I don't mind him because he's not as bad as people say he is. He does go a little overboard sometimes. He's not a great shooter. I like the Jeff Green signing because it wasn't a lot of money and he's a guy that can teach these guys. But for guys like Jayson Tate, Tari Eason, who played great last year, we're not seeing a lot of them because the Rockets are just bringing in draft picks. They're bringing in free agents and shit like that. So Tate and Eason, who are guys that I think should be playing and were good when they played, just aren't right now. So I do agree with this. There are only 144 minutes to be had at spots 2 through 4 in the lineup. Jalen Green, Dylan Brooks, Jabari Smith, Amen Thompson, Tari Eason, and Cam. And they drafted Cam Whitmore. I totally forgot about that. So Cam, yeah, you add Cam into the Tari Eason, the Jabari Smith, and all that shit. Jayson Tate is just not a guy that's playing right now, to be honest with you. So Buddy Hield, you don't really think about it. It's like Cordell Patterson with like kick returns. If you know anything about football, Buddy Hield is one of the greatest shooters of all time. In terms of the numbers, like you see it, like, and every team can use shooting. Every single team can use shooting. It doesn't, you can always add more shooting. From indicating that it might be last season with the Pacers, Buddy Hield is one of the best outside shooters, right? Best shooters of all time, which should make him viable throughout the league. Some team, yeah. Every team needs shooting. So we will see which team that will be. And Los Angeles Clippers. I mean, I can't really fault him for this because in terms of this article, I'm in the future. Hindsight is 2020. I've given my thoughts on the Harden trade. Lost. Ooh, Lakers trade D'Lo, who's been playing okay as of right now. You add Gabe Vincent, you have Austin Reeves. Maybe this is a give Austin Reeves more on-ball touches thing. You have LeBron James, who you can use as a point guard, of course. So I'm not opposed to him being expendable. But again, I just wish they had trade offers with the shit so I could, like, gauge. So, yeah, I can see it. I can see it. Chamberlain Center. Oh, they got my boy Rob up here. Okay. So, I've said this with Clint Capella. I've said this with Jared Allen. Rob with them would be nice because I'm a huge Rob fan. The defensive capabilities, if Rob could get back to the level that he once played at, I think it'd be good. Rob also has expanded his range a little bit, right? I've watched every Rob game of his career as a Celtic, so I knew that Rob could shoot the mid-range a little bit. I knew he had that in his game, but he's doing it way more often now. He's in a situation where he can try some things offensively, and I think he's made a mid-range every single game he's played this season. It's only four. For a guy that was not dependent on to stretch the floor even a little bit with the Celtics, to see him consistently be able to do that now is just a welcome sight. So, the Grizzlies, Rob, Clint Capella, Jared Allen. You know, Steve Nash is out for the season. Jaw's out 25 games. I think Derrick Rose just got injured his knee. Hopefully it's nothing, because that would suck. But I do like this. I really do like this. I like Rob better with them because, again, he's younger. But I think they would actually have to give up something to get Rob. Probably picks. I'm not sure. But I think Capella will be the less valuable out of the three. And Capella's a 10-10 guy every night, so I don't mind this. They also have Kelly Olynyk to add wins, which is cool, I guess. The Miami Heat trade Tyler Hero. I can't say I agree with this only because I don't know who they'll be trading for. The whole offseason, it was Tyler Hero for Dame. You know, it was Hero, maybe Hawkins, Jovic, and some picks for Dame. There is going to be another star player who gets disgruntled and who asks for a trade. It happens every season, right? But as of right now, I just can't see who that would be. And Tyler Hero is playing with a bit of a chip on his shoulder. He has been good so far this season to start. Until somebody becomes available, I don't really know who this could be for. If somebody becomes available, I can see this happening. But as of right now, I can't. The Bucks are done make. I don't think this is true for majority of the same reasons why I think the Celtics aren't done, because the team is complete. Now, Milwaukee might not have the assets the Celtics do, which could be a part of the reason why. 3 years, right, 3 years after emptying their asset bank for Jrue Holiday, the Milwaukee Bucks are saying, right. So, maybe this isn't they're done trading because they're complete. Maybe this is they're done trading because they don't have shit to trade. This says the Bucks don't have control over their own first-round pick. The Pelicans is a swap, so that wouldn't count in this. So I guess I'll just go with this and say they can't trade that first because it's a swap. They don't really have a lot of assets to trade, so Minnesota Timberwolves don't trade Garland Towns. Yeah, I don't see this happening right now. They do have, yeah, the one thing you can say is they have a lot of money tied into their guys. Carl Towns makes $36 million. They gave Anthony Edwards the max. They just gave Jaden McDaniels the max. Gobert has a max. They extended Naz Reid. Yeah, I don't see them moving Towns, in part because I don't think teams want Towns right now. He's still a really good player, but $36 million, those lineups where Anthony Towns at the five or Naz Reid's at the five, this provides a lot more spacing for Ant to score. He's still going to average 25 or 26, you know what I'm saying? So it doesn't really matter that much at this point, but the Timberwolves are a team that I think needs a point guard. I respect the hell out of Mike Conley. They have Nickeil Alexander-Walker, who's playing like the 3-and-D role right now, but a healthy Lonzo Ball on this team would be kind of insane. But do they take the chance on them right now? I don't know, right? I like Mike Conley a lot, but I think they need a young point guard beside Ant, Jaden, and Kat. I'm not saying they should do the Lonzo thing, but a healthy Lonzo Ball be really good in this team. New Orleans Pelicans don't make a trade. They're a good team. If Zion and Brandon Ingram are healthy, this is a 5-6 seed. I mean, yeah, this is a team I don't think makes a lot of trades. I think they have their core in place for this season, especially. I don't see them trading Herb. I don't see them trading Trey Murphy. Of course not Zion or Brandon Ingram. I don't see them trading CJ again, who's been good, but I think CJ's older and his contract, I don't think that's attractive to teams. Valanciunas, I think he's one of the more expendable pieces in their rotation. I just don't think they need trades at this point, right? So that's cool. We got next trade, Evan Fournier. They're going to have to attach a pick or something attractive, because Fournier is not an attractive piece to NBA teams anymore. I remember when the Knicks took the Celtics' whole starting backcourt. They signed Kemba. They signed Evan Fournier that same offseason. They just haven't been good. They don't fit Tom Thibodeau's style of player. And even though Evan Fournier kills the Celtics, he doesn't do that to any other team. And he doesn't play. So I understand them wanting to trade Evan Fournier and that he should be traded. But I don't know what team does this if you're not attaching attractive assets to Evan Fournier. Oklahoma City Thunder don't do anything dramatic. Yeah, I agree with this. I think at some point with all the picks and all the young guys they've accumulated, they will have to do something dramatic, as they'll run into the thing that the Rockets are coming up to now, where guys that deserve to play can't, because they just have a lot of pieces they want to play and develop. But Chet looks great. Shea looks great. J-Dub looks great. They're a team that likes to take contracts on because they have cap space. They just were part of the James Harden trade. Of course, they're not sending out any players, but they're also like the Spurs who facilitated the Max Strus deal, I believe. They got Chetty Osman just because they're a team that has cap space. So I think they're going to be one of those teams, which of course isn't anything dramatic. So Orlando Magic trade John Isaac. I've been banking on Jonathan Isaac coming back and being slightly to his form, because he's had a lot of time to rehab. He's had a lot of time to think, and just his offense wasn't the thing that got him on the court. I think John Isaac, when he was healthy, was going to be a defensive player of the year type of guy. He was able to guard all five positions. He's 6'11", he's athletic, he has long arms, and he's smart at that side of the court. And before he got hurt in 2020, he was just starting to kind of find his way offensively, or at least starting to get there. He's had some flashes this season, you know what I'm saying, of being that defensive guy. I think a team could take a chance on him. They need to clear some space for guys like Jet Howard. It's just kind of tough to see a team trading for John Isaac right now. I think he's still on that $17 million yet. Yep, as it says right here, Isaac, $17.4 million salary this season. That makes him more valuable. Is only partially guaranteed this season and is entirely non-guaranteed next season. So it's sort of like the Hayward thing, where like his contract makes it not that much of a risk. Even though these are guys that are injury prone, they could be good in a role, and it's not that much of a risk because their contracts aren't going to be on your books for a long time. 76, again, I'm in hindsight, so we'll just go past that one. Phoenix Suns are done making trades. I feel like they still need defense, I'm not gonna lie. But again, this might be an asset thing where they just don't have anything to trade. I think if the Suns need to make a deal, they'll make one. So I can't really say that any team is done making trades, because you never know what can come up. Injuries can come up and things can happen. So I'm never gonna say a team is done making trades. If they don't end up making a trade, that's cool. But I can't say that right now. Trailblazers trade Malcolm Brogdon. Yeah, I think this is nice, because he's, you know, there was some talk about him being injured and he's not the same player, all this. Malcolm Brogdon was great for us, the Celtics, I mean, right up until he got hurt in the Heat series, right? Averaging 15.6 man a year. And he's shown that he is still that player with the Trailblazers here. And he's playing with the Blazers, right? He's right behind Scoot. He's playing a lot. He's scoring. He's assisting. And if he continues to show that he's the player he was with the Celtics, I think they'll get a lot of suitors in no time. So I don't mind this at all. Sacramento Kings have split Marcus Harrison Barnes. Harrison Barnes is a 3-and-D wing with size. Getting a little bit older. But I guess this is a Keegan thing. They're trying to get more room for Keegan, and he doesn't fit the timeline, so some draft assets, maybe like a couple seconds for Harrison. I don't mind that at all. Spurs trade Doug McDermott again. No matter how low value they are, we just seen a guy like Matt Ryan put up 20 for the Pelicans because he's a shooter. No matter how low value they are, you can never have enough shooters. Doug McDermott is a shooter. I don't know what his contract is like right now. Long range specialist is on a third. Oh, expiring. Okay. He's a marksman who's on an expiring deal that is attractive to NBA teams. Toronto Raptors trade multiple veterans. This needs to happen. Scottie Barnes has been on a tear to start the season. We're finally seeing that point forward Scottie role. Schroeder, who has been good this season, is always a quality vet. But a guy like Pascal, they can get some more dynamic young guys on this team. I think the Raptors could have a totally new look, and their fan base can look forward to something other than an eighth seed or a play-in berth and a first-round exit. Their ceiling is making the playoffs. The worst place you could be as an NBA franchise is stuck in the fucking middle. Oh, and I think the Washington Wizards went through this too. They were a team that, with Bradley Beal and John Wall, they were always a playoff team. They never could get to the conference finals. They was always in the second round. They lost every single year. Then you lose John Wall to injuries and all that stuff, right? Then you get Porzingis. You still got Bradley Beal, but he's hurt this season. You're like, you're not in the playoffs now. You might as well trade him and try to build for the future. That's what they're doing now. Raptors need to do this. Jazz trade Kelly Olynyk. Yeah, he's a good big man who, again, can shoot. And is this deal expiring? I don't know what Kelly Olynyk's contract is. I know he's making a little bit of money, but I don't know if it's expiring or not. But cool. And he's averaging three. Right. Kelly Olynyk is a great passer. He's a great passer. He averaged 12 points and 4 assists last season. And again, he can shoot. So yeah, he's a guy that can definitely help a contending team. Last but not least, Washington was exploring market for Kyle Kuzma. I don't know about this because they just signed Kyle Kuzma. I think everything's on the table for the Wizards at this point. You know, if they can get more draft capital, they don't have great picks. They do have theirs, which should be high this season. But if they could get multiple young guys and maybe a pick or two for Kyle Kuzma, I wouldn't be opposed to it. It just depends on who it is, really. But that's the video, guys. If you enjoyed it, please do a like, subscribe, share, and then once you can, just bring you out there a little bit more. That being said, this is Nick. I'll be back Saturday. Celtics play the Nets. I'll be back for that post game. This is Nick. Peace.